program you're about to see has a serious technical flaw. The audio is very distorted. I'm not even going to try to explain why. I'm just going to hang my head in shame, because as you all know, I pride myself on good audio. But it will be very difficult to reproduce this content, and so I just apologize. Ham Radio Now, episode 177. So, you want a mobile communications vehicle, do ya? I'm Gary Pierce, Scan4AQ. Sitting along in the co-pilot seat is...
It's Jeff, AC4ZO.
And look, I've got split screen working. Cool.
Oh,
so yeah, Jeff is back, and it's good to have you back. You haven't been on the show in a while, have you?
No.
You didn't get mad at me or anything, did you?
No, it's nothing like that. It's not that I think this is a bad use of my time.
I was gonna apologize to you, because this is a beautiful Sunday afternoon. You could be outside.
Yeah, I've been working on Christmas lights for 4 days now.
Okay, so maybe we'll get a picture of what the things look like.
Sure.
Not in this show, but in some show coming up.
Okay.
So this mobile communications unit deal, let me add someone in between us. Uh-oh, we have internet connection problems, according to Skype. It's Adam Carroll, KF7LJH. Hello, Adam. Can you hear me now?
I sure can. Hey, guys. It's great to be on.
And the reason we're doing this show is not you, but a buddy of yours, Robert Anglin. Did I pronounce that right?
You sure did.
WX5TEX sent me email saying, could I plug something that you guys are doing? And I said, plugging things, it doesn't sound very much like fun at all. But I'll put you on the air and let you talk about it. And so what you want to do is... some kind of a mobile comm van. Have I got that right?
You're absolutely right, Gary. I work with Multnomah County Aries here in Portland, Oregon. And I'm sure like most Aries groups around the country, we don't have a communications trailer that we can use for events and drills and for extended incidents where we're out in the field for a long time. And we've always wanted one. And I'm sure like most groups out there, we'd said, hey, we should... get a trailer.
Yeah.
Which brings me to the
point that I told you I was going to ask you at the very beginning of this. The first question I was going to ask, what are you, nuts?
You know, it's funny. I was thinking about that. I don't think nuts is the right word. I think naive and stupid might be a better description, really, in hindsight. We kicked this off after three, four months of planning. We kicked this off 2 weeks ago. And I massively underestimated the level of work, both in just the planning stage, but in the volunteer organizing. Oh, my gosh. It's practically a full-time job.
So the other question I was going to ask you was, were you inspired by the previous Ham Radio Now programs? You'd mentioned an email to me. You'd seen the program before. You're a fan of the show. So have you been inspired by... previous Ham Radio Now programs about comm units? We've done one from Dayton. Remember the one from Dayton, Jeff?
No, I do.
Yeah, I mean, that was huge. Mm-hmm. But they got money to spend.
Yeah.
And one from Brevard County, Florida.
Right.
And we did those in one episode not too long ago. Those were your inspirations, right, Adam?
Very much so. You know, I'll tell you, Bear One is an incredible unit. I was really excited.
This is Bears One. Bears is the Brevard Emergency Amateur Radio Service.
But that Red Cross truck that you had in the other episode.
This is the Red Cross ECRV, the Emergency Response Communications Vehicle. There's 12 of these in the country scattered around.
The toy and nerd factor associated with that particular unit was so impressive that it definitely got me and my cohorts talking. But if you do a Google image search for communications trailer, you know, for the nerds watching, you know, that is hours of surfing right there.
And there's bad news on that. I don't know if you came across the note. I think it was on ARL's website that the Red Cross has decommissioned those. So I don't know what the deal is behind it, why they decided they didn't want or need them anymore, but those units are no longer.
I heard that as well. I heard they were collapsing to more portable kits that weren't really vehicle-based, I think is what I heard.
Yeah. So everybody makes their own decisions.
They probably figured out what it cost them.
Oh, I know. The maintenance on those things must have been insane.
So you're saying that you went through a lot of rapid knowledge increase. You've learned a lot. What kind of stuff have you considered? What did you discover you needed to know that you didn't know? What was the big surprise?
The legal aspects was the shock. I thought this was a trailer. It was pretty much akin to, you know, something I'd tow my garbage with in my truck. And I didn't really understand that it was almost car-like in its requirement for a title and registration, liability insurance, sort of kind of some of the mechanical process around owning a trailer. Multnomah County Aries, and I think most Aries groups, aren't actually a business entity or a 501c.
I love it when it does that.
It's tough for them to actually own anything. Yeah, so we ended up coordinating with our local amateur radio club, Portland Amateur Radio Club, and it's a great group of guys. They've always sort of they're one of several clubs here in the Multnomah County, but we work a lot with them. And so we were able to approach them and say, hey, we're really interested in this project and fundraising for a communications trailer. Would you be willing to help? And they said, Adam, we sure would. We think it's a great idea. The one thing is that, you know, maybe we could use it for ham outreach the weekends you guys aren't using it. Take it to fix-it fairs and sort of promote the ham radio hobby. And I said, wow, that is a great idea. Let's march forward. So about 12 board meetings later, we got everybody on board. The accountants had been talked to, the 501c paperwork had been reviewed, and the board voted to support the project, which basically meant we were able to use their 501c status for fundraising, so our deductions were tax deductible, plus ultimately they could own the trailer from a legal point of view. I sort of, in our initial planning, you know, maybe the two sentences right after "we should have a trailer" definitely weren't "what's the liability aspect for this?" So that was sort of the rude awakening. I'd say from a learning point of view, we're pretty early into this, but one thing that's become clear is the sheer amount of volunteer support we've been getting. It's been great. I was underprepared to organize and manage and kind of effectively task manage that many volunteers. We didn't have maybe the paperwork they would need to go out and say, and to promote the project if they're going to go to, say, like REI, who is big right here in Portland. We can walk up to them, to their headquarters, and say, hey, can you support this project? But I didn't have like a one-pager. All I had for a project documentation point of view was really this 12-page wall of text that nobody's going to read. So having some proper marketing material was something kind of we came late to the party. So it's been a lot of little things like that.
Jeff, this is the Adam Show.
Yeah, he's doing great.
Does not need us to sit here and ask him any questions. You know, he knows. Knows his
Sorry stuff. About that.
It's okay. I got the website up here for the Portland Amateur Radio Club, and what I was going to ask about, which you kind of pretty much said, but we'll go to a little bit more detail on, is well, first of all, you guys are an Aries group. That's the website for the Multnomah County Aries. I take it that's an Indian. Indian name, Native American name for the county?
It is. Multnomah County, there's a large Native American, a lot of tribes and reservations here, both historically and today, but the original name for the area was Multnomah.
All right, and the big city is Portland, Oregon.
That's right. Portland's the biggest city in Multnomah, in Oregon, actually.
How many hams are in the area, in the county, if you know? Or
well, you know, I actually looked that up. We considered sending flyers to all the hams in the county, and there's about 8,000.
Okay, so that's pretty big. In the county? 8,000 in the county?
In the county, yeah.
Because, you know,
18,000 total in Oregon.
Okay, that is, we're in North Carolina. There's 2,000 hams in Wake County. There might be like 2,500 now. It's kind of an old statistic. And around 20,000 in the whole state. So that, of course, out where you guys are, Oregon is a huge state, and everybody lives in Portland.
90% of the population of Oregon is in Multnomah County.
There's the Aries group. I'll talk to you a little bit more about your Aries group in a little bit. But it sounds like you have a very close connection to the radio club, to the Portland Amateur Radio Club. You're not exactly the same thing, but probably a very very tight. A lot of crossover between the people involved in both groups.
Exactly. About half the members in Multnomah County Aries are actually PARC or Portland Amateur Radio Club members as well. There are really two clubs that we work closely with in Multnomah County Aries. It's the Portland Amateur Radio Club and the Hoodview Amateur Radio Club. And they're based out of Gresham, which is just a little bit east of Portland. It's really kind of a Portland bedroom community, sort of neighborhood of Portland. And the Hoodview there, they're both really active clubs. Hoodview's a little more active these days than Portland Amateur Radio Club, but we're working on achieving some parity there.
And there's my camera. You discovered that funding, it's helpful to have an infrastructure in place, and the Portland Club has the IRS 501c3, that's the nonprofit. So that was an easy way to go rather than try to get incorporated with Aries and do all the 501c3 yourself?
Absolutely. Especially recently now, there's a little more administrative burden associated with 501c3. You're sending a lot more paperwork each year. There's also quite a bit of paperwork you have to do if you, as a nonprofit, if you do a large fundraising effort. And we just weren't, there was no one in Multnomah County Aries experienced with that, but the Portland Amateur Radio Club guys were very experienced with it. In fact, we didn't even know about it until they brought it up and said, you know, these are sort of the legal guidelines that you need to follow. And we were like, great. Oh, man, this we would have run into some serious problems about month two of if we actually get the money and start a build. By month two, we would have been sideways in a couple legal ways. And so having Portland Amateur Radio Club come in and kind of solve all that at the beginning was really key. You speak about infrastructure, though. There was another key piece of infrastructure to support the fundraising that I didn't really understand that we needed. Today, social networking provides an avenue for fundraising that hasn't been available in the past. And, you know, when I was starting to investigate this, you know, people were saying, hey, you know what, I have a job and I'm not penniless, but I don't really want to pay out of my own pocket to go visit Bette Midler. So could you guys give me $1,500 to go visit Bette Midler? This was actually a fundraising campaign that I saw. And they had raised $1,500 in 3 days. And this guy was off to see Bette Midler.
Jeff is giving me a very quizzical expression.
He's got better friends than I have.
Seriously. I was like, if that guy can go see Bette Midler for, you know, for free, then I think we have a chance of being able to create something for the community that derives maybe a little more benefit. You know, Bette Midler is a big deal, I know, but a little more benefit than that.
I thought Bette Midler had retired years ago. I guess she's still touring or doing something.
I guess so.
I like her music and stuff and the movies, but it's not a thing anymore.
Well, you know, it was really at that point I thought, you know, this could be something we could leverage to do something with if it's that easy. Well, of course, it's not that easy. Have fundraising through your social network. It turns out it helps a lot if you have a social network to start with. The Multnomah County Aries had a Facebook page, but didn't, like most Aries clubs, I'm sure, we really didn't promote it or keep it very active or, you know, really organize or communicate through that Facebook page. And so now all of a sudden, we started pasting all this stuff to our Facebook page and saying, hey, you know what, this is a great opportunity and you guys should help us out. And we were screaming to a group of like three people.
Yeah, nobody saw it.
Nobody had seen it. We hadn't really taken the effort to build a community or to build a social network, build an understanding that they could communicate with us through that method. And so in hindsight, that would have been something maybe we would have been building beforehand. If I could give a suggestion for anybody considering this, if you're thinking you might do this in the future, start Facebook promoting now.
Jeff, you do a little bit of Facebook stuff.
I check in on it about maybe once a week, or if Bobby tells me something's going on, then more often.
Yeah, I don't think that social media in general is a big thing for hams.
To me, social media is anything but.
Yeah, now you're younger than me by quite a bit, and younger than Jeff by 15 minutes or so, it looks like. Well, by hair color, you're quite a bit younger. In your experience, is there social media in ham radio? I mean, is there a ham radio audience that is using social media significantly at all?
I really haven't experienced that. As far as I've seen, there really hasn't been a strong social media presence in ham radio. There are a couple of exceptions. The mesh, HSM mesh guys are pretty active on Facebook. At least there's a Northwest Facebook page for HSM mesh that's pretty active. I know, do you really want to count the Yahoo groups as social media or not? I don't think you could.
Yeah, no, they're basically mailing lists.
Yeah.
Bulletin board type things. And we had the original social media, and we had, Packet and all that stuff. And I think bulletin boards back before the internet was a deal, I think hams got excited about things like that. But once the Facebooks and Twitters and stuff came around, hams used them. But I don't think that they are the big deal.
No, and I know for me personally, I'm not a big Twitterer or Facebooker myself. So I don't know. I guess maybe I fit the ham demographic just like everybody else.
Yeah.
But there were, luckily, Robert, the one who contacted you, he's pretty active on Facebook, and we have a lot of members that get introduced to Multnomah County Aries through
Let's give Robert
city
a proper
emergency
plug,
preparedness.
Your audio
not necessarily.
Whoa, your audio disappeared when you were saying Robert's name. Let's give him a proper plug.
Robert Anglin, he is my co-leader along with Deb for this project, and he's done a huge amount of work. Oops.
Yeah, it's kind of coming and going, but
it's we're doing okay.
Yeah, we'll struggle through. It's propagation, coast to coast propagation here. It can be difficult. All right, so the social media wasn't really there. What did you do?
So we just we had at it basically. Robert and another team member. We basically had three people assigned to start sort of pushing social media, taking the time to like the page and push that element out to go to other ham radio, amateur radio clubs and kind of promote our site on their site. Say, hey, would you be willing to post a link or like to our Facebook page? And what was funny was a lot of that outreach was actually not through social media. You know, we were sending emails and making phone calls to these guys saying, hey, would you mind promoting us through your social media channels? Which has had, I'd say, a medium amount of success.
I'm going to see if I can dial up your page here. Yeah, there you are. So you're there. You got 23 likes.
It's us, Justin Bieber, really.
Yeah.
You know, I'm right there.
You're right behind him. you got some stuff going on. Yeah, That looks an awful lot like ham radio to me. You at least have a good picture up there. Somebody's doing some good graphics for you.
Yeah, actually, Robert is an outstanding photographer, and most of our graphics are coming from him.
All right, so you got Facebook involved. It doesn't look like it took you too far. What else did you do?
We went a more traditional fundraising route, which was really kind of trying to create a email list that we could blast emails out to. And so, but we have to be sort of careful. Today, there's a lot of rules around spam. If you're using a tool like MailChimp, which is what we used, MailChimp is great. It's an online tool that allows you to create a very web graphic intensive email and then send that out to a list of people, and it gives you all this data back after you send it. So we created basically a simple ask email. Hey, this is Multnomah County Aries. We'd like you to fundraise. This is what we're doing. And we crafted it in MailChimp and then came up with about 400 to 600 emails. I had a bunch of bounces, so the actual list ended up being about 450 emails that went out. And that took about a month to kind of collect those emails. We really didn't want to be super spammy about it, so we only wanted to use emails that we had harvested from people who had said they were interested in ham radio. So these would be members of local amateur radio clubs, people, the local ARL dignitaries in the state. We hit other Aries units, one in each county. We hit them and blasted that email. And what was really interesting was when we sent the email out, MailChimp gives you a ridiculous number of statistics, like says, okay, well, you sent this to Fred at 4:22 p.m., and he opened it at 5:26 and chose not to click on your link. So now when I open emails I get from other people that are obviously part of a campaign tool, I'm a lot more cautious about what I'm doing because now I know, wow, they can literally watch me click on their email.
You are being tracked.
Oh, man. It's the whole privacy thing these days is pretty interesting.
All right. So you sent out those emails. Two things. What kind of response did you get? And what mechanism did you have for people to send you money?
We had, again, actually, I know pretty detailed how it went. Of the emails that went out, we had 887 people open the email. And because there were a lot of forwards, which was great. Of that, less than 8% actually clicked on the link that goes to our Indiegogo-based fundraising page.
Okay, so Indiegogo is your method for doing the collection.
It is.
And I just happen to have that sitting up here right there. You are at $1,520 USD with a goal of 10,000. So
that's right.
15% of the way and 51 days left to go. Let's see what else it says here. Okay, so you got some text and some more text and some more text and even some more text.
Yeah, it's pretty wall of texty. That was one of the issues we ran. A lot of the feedback from the site we've been getting, which we kicked off. Indiegogo does 60-day campaigns. It's kind of the way they're set up. And so we started ours 9 days ago. We've been getting some feedback that it's sort of a waterfall of text, and we need to break it up with some graphics, something we're working on right now.
Yeah. When I first looked at it a couple of days ago, it was at 700-some. So it's just about double that. You've also got a video going here. Let's take a quick look at that.
ACBS was just reporting an estimated 5.2 in the San Jose area. It hasn't been well defined yet.
W6NLG, check back.
Okay, all stations stand by.
Okay, this is N6FW, net control.
Are there any reports of damage?
Yeah, media reports 50-foot section of the Oakland Bay Bridge is down. The bridge is closed.
Net control, K6TJE.
Stand by. I've got an earthquake going on here right now.
That audio you just heard was amateur radio volunteers during the Northridge earthquake in 1994. Hi, I'm Eli.
And I'm Deb.
And we're with Multnomah County Area.
Okay, so you got the Eli and Deb there. And oops, that's the button that I was going to push. They're doing the pitch for you. And you got somebody that's got some video skills.
Again, that's Robert, our AV master. He's taking care. He's the man behind the camera there. It was sort of a collective effort to write the script. And Deb and Eli are really some of our most well-spoken members. And so we tapped them for the
okay.
video.
And so Robert, Robert knows this, but one clue for anybody doing this sort of thing. And Jeff, you probably encountered this working with me. Video is relatively easy. Audio. It's very difficult. So,
yeah. So you want it to sound good.
Yeah. They were using the microphone that was on the camera. They were a long ways away from it, so they sound terrible. but their message gets across okay. Which is why Jeff and I are sitting in front of these honking microphones, and we sound good.
Well, you know, after a couple takes, we decided that rather than a bunch of polish, maybe going the other direction and making it, I'm not going to say Saturday morning cartoon show, but, you know, making it feel a little homespun was more honest to our message and, you know, certainly a lot faster.
All right. So if somebody wants to help out, and I don't think you're looking to get contributions from hams all over the country necessarily, but you never know, like that sending somebody to see Bette Midler. You know, it could happen. So the Indiegogo may be a little bit hard to come up with. The easy way to find it, I have discovered, is on the Portland Amateur Radio Club website, which any Google search will get you to that, but it is w7lt.org. And just down here, just a little bit, is the link that will take you to the Aries page. You know, it isn't on your Aries page. Your Aries page says nothing about this.
I know. I was just talking to our webmaster two nights ago, and he's like, Adam, I swear I'll get to it over the weekend.
Well, he's going to be embarrassed into doing it now. So
yeah, no kidding.
We'll take care of you. So you had a choice to make. Well, a lot of choices to make about which way you wanted to go. The two units that we saw and the one Red Cross unit were all three, the Dayton unit, the Brevard County, and the Red Cross were all full drivable units, vans or buses. And it doesn't sound like you decided you wanted to do that. Sound like you wanted to do a trailer type.
And as you can imagine, that was the subject of much debate. Ultimately, it was the flexibility of a trailer, the ability to take it to a site. And let's say if I towed it and then wanted to go home and leave everybody there to run the operation, that was feasible. It wasn't really as feasible with a vehicle-based solution. But the main reason was the mechanical upkeep. You know, you've got this whole drivetrain you've got to keep care of. You know, if my truck breaks down, there's a bunch of other trucks in the club that can tow it out. Or, you know, they can. It's not like I have to tow it everywhere. You know, there's going to be multiple people who will be able to tow it. There was also just the simplicity of ownership. That was the other big thing. Insurance gets a lot more complicated with a vehicle, as well as title and registration. So those issues exist with a trailer, but I mean, insurance, for example, it's a tenth, not even a tenth for a trailer than what it is for a vehicle.
Jeff, do you have a preference which way you'd rather?
Oh, for sure, a trailer. That's a great idea. All the reasons Adam mentioned, plus when you want to take it somewhere, lots of places have a lot of restrictions on a vehicle that they don't have on a trailer. So just the ease of deploying it would be a big thing.
All right. So the guys in Brevard County, the guys in Dayton, don't know what they're talking about. I'm sure they went through the same discussions that you guys did. And they reached a different conclusion, but maybe they had a way to do it. One of the things that we have seen every time an idea comes up at a radio club meeting, it comes up with approximately this language: we should do something. And that "we" is very nebulous. How did the idea get started with you guys?
I went to a ham radio fair here in Portland, and there was a show. It was an emergency communications vehicle show. So the county had their big band tour bus sized emergency communications trailer there. Vehicle there. And there were a number of other trailers, and I just got green with envy. And I turned to my Aries member who I was with, and I said, you know what, we need one of those. Just like I'm sure everybody has said 100 times. Yeah, exactly, we. I ended up talking to our EC, the head of our Aries unit, about it. And he said something very telling, I thought. He said, Adam, the only way this will ever happen is if one person or a handful of people within the club make it a personal priority. They take it as a special mission. It's going to be hard to kind of collectively gather enough enthusiasm to do that much work. And I thought about that for a while. And I did speak to one other member of Aries who was willing to sort of throw in with me. And so it started with the two of us. And once we got some of the other members saw us working that hard and some of the stuff we started to generate, that just generated enthusiasm within the club. And there was a snowball effect to it. Now the project team's about 12 people. I'm actually able to delegate tasks and sleep at night. And so so it's been working out well since then.
But it still ended up with you being the guy who was going to be the point person.
Ultimately, there had to be a project manager, yeah. Sort of.
Was it a volunteer deal, or did you say, were you the, everyone else stepped back and you stood still?
Yeah, it was even more so. No one, there wasn't even a line. I sort of just walked up and said, hey, I'm doing this. Does anybody want to join? And there turned out, luckily, there were a few.
That is the maybe the biggest surprise that I would get from the whole deal, was that a lot of people thought, not that it was just a good idea, but that they were willing to participate, put in some elbow grease.
Well, a lot of times that participation doesn't deal with the infrastructure, with the basic stuff that Adam's having to deal with. Probably lots of people have ideas on what equipment should be in there, how it should be installed, how it should be operated, and all of that, because that's the fun part, but you can't get to that until you've handled all these other issues.
Yeah. So where do things stand right now?
Right now, we're so this is a two-month effort, so we're going to be wrapping up towards the end of January. What's great is not only have we had the contributions to the website, but we've got some emails in saying, hey, I work at this company and we have a grant opportunity that I think this would be great. We actually had two people come and approach with those. And either one of those awards could be the total amount we need. And we're also now starting to spread out with corporate solicitations. So our team of 10 or so people have a little list of companies they're going to call, and we're hoping they might be able to make a contribution.
Have you even gotten to the point of trying to figure out how this is going to get configured or what you want in it? Or is it, let's be real first and see if we're even going to be able to do it?
What's been interesting, as I get feedback back, I get about 100 emails with suggestions for how to build the trailer for every one email I get saying, hey, I'm willing to help fundraise. So we had to have some sort of message to when we sent this out. We couldn't just say, hey, we're going to build something and we're going to decide later. So we set some goals. We want it to be a smaller trailer. Bear One was a monster. That thing was awesome. But this is Portland. I mean, everyone drives a Prius or want to tow this thing with a herd of bicycle, you know? So we couldn't make it too big. So we have a goal of under 3,500 pounds. We want pretty fancy power. And when people push me to define that, I'd like it to be multiple source. I'd like it to have a generator. I'd like it to be solar. We're going to be taking this to lots of events. I think a solar solution, especially here in the Northwest, is going to draw a lot of eyeballs. So I'd like that to be a piece of it. And then most importantly, it needs to have air conditioning and heating, because really what this is a mobile house for radio operators. I mean, we can bring our own gear if we have to.
What kinds of things? You went through a quick list of what you wanted to be able to do with it at the beginning of the program, but take a little time now. What sort of things have you got in mind, and what... what have you been doing in the past that you kept saying, boy, I wish I had a comm trailer to run this event with?
The main drive for this was we found when the way our Ares group is set up is we have served agencies, the Oregon Food Bank, the county ECC, the city ECC, these locations that are pretty well built out. Through drills, we discovered that running net control from one of these stations at the same time they were, you know, behaving as a served agency with traffic coming in and out, it was too chaotic. It was too insane, and we couldn't really place net control at one of these locations. So we started having a portable net control. For drills, you know, sometimes we'd run it out of our house. But if we were being serious, we'd go throw a tent up at a large park or a high elevation park here in town and run net control from there. Last year I did this, and you know, there was ice on the outside of the tent. Of course, I brought my little, you know, Mr. Buddy heater and forgot the propane tank for it. You know, it was every time we did the portable net control, there was some sort of drama associated with it. And so that was our initial impetus to having what we called at the time a net control kit. And that evolved into this trailer idea. So from an Aries usage point of view, that's the key driver. But as we started to think about more we could do, the training opportunities, we have a lot of training events, both for Aries hams and for just hams in the city that are involved with emergency communications here in Portland. And so again, we're setting up tents for those types of things. We think we could get a better draw and have better events with a resource like this trailer. But what the Portland Amateur Radio Club brought into it when we started working with them, they're community focused, and they said, Adam, you know, we'd love to take this and park it outside of a school and do show and tell and really show electronics and radio and the fun of learning to a bunch of kids. You know, I'm not going to say I'm going to throw an Xbox in the trailer, but, you know, there might be one in there to generate some interest at things like Maker Faires. Here in the Northwest, Maker Faires are super popular. So taking it there, just really what Park is bringing, this idea of a ham radio ambassadorship. And we're really enthusiastic about that idea. We have almost 100 members in Aries, so we feel like we could staff it to do those types of things.
Does your Aries group do the bike tours and walkathons, or is that done through the radio club?
It's a mix. For example, the Aries club does do the local MS walk, but it's the clubs are doing things like the Portland Marathon and the Rose Parade, the Rose Festival Parade we have every year, and some of the larger events. So it's a mix. Again, half of the blend between Portland Amateur Radio Club and Multnomah County Aries, it's practically the same group of people.
Yeah. Some areas, the Aries group considers these events to be really good training. Yeah. Something that you can do and get a lot of communications practice in something that is going to most of the time be less urgent, although sometimes very urgent. You know, some big emergencies happen in these. And some Aries groups say, that's not emergency communication. We don't do that. Radio Club can do it. Sounds like you guys do sort of a mix. You're perfectly willing to jump in with Aries.
Absolutely. I feel a directed net is a directed net. And the procedures and communication style you experience and need to participate with at the Portland Marathon is the exact same that's going to happen in a large event. So we feel they're excellent training opportunities.
All right. I'll talk about your Aries group a little bit more. Let me see if I can dial up the website again. HT and Go kits, which you should be able to... I thought this was cool. To learn what you should be able to do with your radio. If I can... There we go. So this is what you're going to put in your Go kit. But here's what you should be able to do with it. Set a simplex frequency and program a memory. They have some very odd-looking frequencies.
Let's see that. Well, I saw 5.2 on there.
Yeah, 146.52. That's normal. Yeah. 146.48. That's an odd-looking frequency. Why do you have such odd-looking frequencies in your plan?
We have, for whatever reason, his organ's got a weird split. And I don't know what the history behind the weird split is out here, but that's what we use. So we just stick with it.
Yeah, well, 146.48 is a simplex channel, and I was trying to trap you into explaining to everybody that on one side of the Mississippi we do things one way, except for Alabama and Michigan, and on the other side of the Mississippi they do something different, and that is, on the top half of the 2 meter band, on this side of the Mississippi, we do 15 kilohertz space step channels. And for the most part, on that side of the Mississippi, and this is not exclusive, not universal in every state, there's some differences, they do 20 kilohertz step channels. And Jeff, do you remember, you weren't around as a ham back when that happened. Adam, were you around when that happened?
I wasn't around.
Were you even aware that that's the way it is?
I heard it was different, but I have no idea why.
So you haven't traveled to the East much with a handy talkie and tried to program repeaters, it sounds like.
you know, I spent a bunch of time in Boston, but I just programmed them in at home and then just used them when I was over there.
Yeah. I'll do a whole show tutorial. I'm going to do this with Bill Pasternak sometime. But this happened in the 70s. And very briefly, 15 kilohertz is too tight. But 15 kilohertz appeared when we had been at 30 kilohertz channel steps and said, well, we need more frequencies. We've filled up all of the frequencies that we've got with repeaters. We need more. And the commercial people preceding us by a few years had done the same thing. They went from 60 to 30, and they said, well, we'll cut them in half again. We'll do 15 kilohertz. But our signals are 16 kilohertz wide.
Yeah.
You know, that's 5 pounds of poop in a 2-pound bag. Well, 5 pounds of poop in a 4.5-pound bag. It's going to slop out the edges just a little bit. So some guys down in Texas, I think this is where it happened. I was around, but I was a kid, you know, so I was only paying so much attention.
I'm proud you were paying attention at all.
Yeah. Well, I didn't have a girlfriend. So some guys in Texas said, this is stupid. We're not going to do it that way. We're going to bite the bullet and move all of our repeaters to 20 kilohertz channels, which allows for the 16 kilohertz actual width of the signal and a little bit of guard space because your receiver's not that tight.
Right.
And so they did that and took a lot of the states to the west along with them. And Michigan and Alabama, east of the Mississippi, said, sounds like a good idea to us. We're going to go do that. Well, Michigan has all these lakes around them. So they got some geographic spacing except for the border with Ohio and Indiana on the south. But poor Alabama suffers with all the states around them. So there's some clashes all along the border. But in the interior of the state, it works pretty well. So you've got less than 20 kilohertz versus 15 kilohertz. This was before the FCC opened up the bottom part of the band to repeaters. For a period of time, repeaters were isolated to above 146 megahertz. And we said, FCC, we still need more space. We've cut them in half. We've done everything we can. We still need more space. And the bottom half of 2 meters is fallow. No one's doing anything with it. So they said, okay, 144.5 to 145.5, you can put repeaters in. And just to show you how smart you guys out in the West were, everybody made that part of the band 20 kilohertz. And I don't know if you remember this from when we were teaching classes, Jeff. When I talk about 2 meters, I have a phrase. The 2 meter band is carved up like a Halloween pumpkin. Remember that now, don't you?
Yeah, I remember that.
It's a mess. It just grew. It grew by piling one thing on top of another, and it's a mess. The Texas guys did their best to straighten out the mess,
yep.
And a lot of folks went with them, yep. And it seems to work. It ends up with less channels, which was the argument
for... Well, more usable, you know, you can reuse them better.
Yeah, yeah. You can use all of them in one space. The thing you got to do if you're going to do 15 kilohertz channels is have geographic spacing. Most places do 50 miles. So repeaters can't be closer than 50 miles. Otherwise, you get splatter, basically, is what it is. You know,
co-channels can't be closer than 50, right?
Adjacent channels, 15 adjacent kilohertz channel. Adjacent channels, 50 miles. Co-channels, repeaters on the same frequency, 100 to 120 miles, depending on the coverage of the repeater. And that'll just about get it for you.
So the coordinators in the West have a much easier time of it.
They do.
You know how I deal with it? I set my step size to 5 kilohertz and just crank away.
A lot of cranking. Yeah, and the other weird thing, as long as we're talking about this, is in the top half of the band, the 20 kilohertz you guys use in the top half of the band end up like, you know, 146.48 with an even number as the second digit to the right of the decimal point. But in the bottom part of the band, there we go, the bottom part of the band, it's 10 kilohertz off.
Yep.
I don't know.
Organic growth. It's always interesting.
Yeah. All right. So let's see what else you got going here on your... Aries Races. You guys, I don't know how really new this is. It looks like December 31st, 2010. So that's... You got some age on that one, but you decided to combine Aries and Races?
Yeah.
Was there a separate Races at the time?
Not actually, Racy sort of was an unorganized element at the time. And so the state emergency OEM group, Oregon Emergency Management, decided to coexist the Aries and Racy's group together. So we all just turn our hat around if the declaration is made.
Yeah. And a lot of states do that. There, I don't know if there's still any states that have a conflict between Aries and Racy's. There was a big blow up in Virginia a decade or so ago. I mean, they're just at each other. Like, yeah, you know,
about that time, my brother tells me Maryland was having a lot of trouble with the same thing.
Yeah, I think Virginia's got their act together, and you know, it's individuals and personalities. Everybody, you know, build a little kingdom and put things together. Let's see what else we got here. Ah, tsunami safety. That's something we don't hear about here in North Carolina very much, Jeff.
We call them. No, we don't.
No, we could because we've got great big long ocean.
Yeah.
And there could be a tsunami. A tsunami is just a big
could
wave.
Be. Yeah, the winds don't behave themselves, but the waves seem to.
Yeah. Well, we haven't had that problem, I guess. But you guys are waiting for the big one out there?
You know, we have that every 300-year cyclical Cascadia earthquake, the biggest in the world. And the last one was about 300 years ago. So it's very much on our attention from an emergency planning point of view. And, you know, that tsunami wave is going to wash in, you know, almost a mile on that western coast. So we have a lot of tsunami drills on the Oregon coast right now.
Is Portland right on the coast?
It is not. It's about 45 minutes inland. So there's not a tsunami. There's no, you know, Independence Day or, you know, movie style wave that's going to be coming over the top of Portland.
But it'll hit your rural counties to the west on the coast.
Absolutely. You know, that will be, you know, Colombo, Sri Lanka style flooding.
Does Multnomah County go to the coast, or is there another county sitting in there?
Two counties. So there's a two-county buffer between us and them, luckily.
So some other areas group has to worry about that.
That's somebody else's problem.
Yeah. Jeff is sitting here with the bear.
So. He just came by.
Yep, yeah. He's been wandering at our feet for a while. So that's where Jeff went a moment ago, and he ducked off camera. Let's see. Well, the other thing I'll ask. Let's see. Get disaster prep tips. So you got a good looking website that is trying to get people prepared for what they need to do. You're working on your standard operating procedures. Net training, got some mailing lists for people to get together with. So, I keep pushing the wrong button. The usual round of stuff for people to get Aries together with. Have you heard, I ask this whenever I talk to Aries people, have you heard of something called AuxComm?
I have. Isn't that the ARRL version of their training process?
No.
No, that's the FEMA one.
Yeah, AuxComm is a FEMA project, and some states are getting real big into it, and some have just about never heard of it. And I need to do a program pretty much on AuxComm with somebody from FEMA at some point. North Carolina is one of the very early states, and guys I know here in the Aries group were instrumental in AuxComm's development. It's a way for volunteer groups, mostly in communications, but they've got Civil Air Patrol, National Guard, Mars, Ham Radio, Aries, as sort of the umbrella under which, or in under the all these groups fit under that umbrella as they go in and interface with FEMA in the ICS incident command structure and things like that. So
we had several members who went to Salem, the state capital, for AuxComm training, and I remember them telling me about it and that it was, like you say, very procedural based. If these are the forms you want to use, ICS basics. It did seem like a class to how to integrate with FEMA describe it quickly.
Do your guys, I don't see this on the website, and I guess I'm kind of surprised. Do you have a requirement or a recommendation to go through the FEMA courses?
To become a Multnomah County Aries member, we do request that you have ICS 100 100, 200, the non-classroom ones, 100, 200, and 700.
700 and 800 is one that's been added.
Although we encourage 300 and 400 as well, if you can take it.
Yeah, all that training is pretty good. My impression when I did it, I had to do it all four courses to be able to participate with the Red Cross at our state fair for several years. My impression was it was a really good exercise in learning how to do PDF word searches.
the FEMA online classes definitely don't consume your entire attention.
No, they're kind of boring and they're very wonky, and it's layers of overlapping nomenclature. Have you been through any of those courses?
I've been through two of them, either two or three. I can't remember.
You did the Red Cross thing, right?
Yeah.
So you did three.
Okay.
Yeah, evidently long enough ago that you've forgotten most of it.
Oh, yeah. I don't remember. I remember how the course worked and how to get the certificate, but it was so much terminology, you know, what they call these various forms and so forth.
And, yeah. And layers of organization.
Yeah.
Who's got what jobs, things like that. Yeah. All of it looked like it was probably a really good idea, because I think this was born out of chaos.
Yeah.
It was born out of not just hams, in fact, far above hams, all of the various government entities, police departments, fire departments, emergency management at local, state, federal levels,
yep,
bumping into each other and trying to figure out how to work together. And so at some point, somebody put their fist down and said, this is how you work together.
Well, it's good it's defined, but, you know, that's just the normal problem I have with credentialism at all. Going through the courses, I didn't feel like was a very good use of my time at all. Certainly wouldn't help in my function of communications.
Yeah, I would walk into, even after fresh off the boat from doing one of those things, I would walk into a situation knowing that it existed, but not really knowing how it worked. So I could go look at it. When I say it was an exercise in doing word searches, it's an open book test at the end of each section.
Yeah.
And you can go back and look. And what I did was I scraped it all into a PDF file. And then they didn't make it easy, because when you took the multiple choice test, what they asked you for was not purely a repetition of the language they used in the course. Sounds like you're familiar with this. It was a little different. So you had to put, you know, one and one together to make two. And so you had to do a good search to get to the right thing. Once you got there, it wasn't always necessarily 100% clear that these were the two pieces they were talking about. But I think I scored well enough that I got my certificates.
What we found is we like ICS as a unifying structure for how to manage an incident, but ultimately we're beholden to the served agencies that we're working with, and their level of adoption of ICS structure varies very much so. So our goal is really to integrate with who we're asked to serve. We have the ICS background if they're doing it in an ICS style. If they're not, you know what, we'll use the forms they give us.
All right. So to wrap up, we got your Indiegogo campaign, and this address is far too long for anybody to try to remember, so don't worry about that. If you want to try to find it easily, just go to the Portland Amateur Radio Club, and there's their link for the Indiegogo. And we want to see this number climb as rapidly as possible and hit your $10,000 goal. With Indiegogo, if I recall, you are able to get money back even if you don't meet the whole goal.
Yes, yes. We looked at a lot of the different fundraising sites. We looked at 8, actually. We ended up going with Indiegogo. Basically, they incent you to have a realistic goal, both by constraining the time frame for your campaign, in this case, 60 days, The other thing they do is basically there are a bunch of fees that you pay Indiegogo for the convenience of using their site. If you hit your goal, it's a much reduced fee schedule is sort of the way they incent you to do that. But they'll still send you the money minus the fees.
Yeah, I've done the Kickstarter thing a couple of times. And there, you do have some nail biting toward the end if you're real close to that goal and hasn't quite made it there. So I've had two successful ones and one dismal failure.
Both, that's pretty good odds.
Yeah. Well, the two successful ones were the Tapper Digital Communications Conference. And that's sort of a highly motivated group of people that want these videos to be made and want me to get out there and be able to do it. And the total failure was, it was me, my fault for the most part, I think, because the design was to get Ham Radio Now, basically you and me, out to some ham fests. I think we were talking about going to Orlando and Dayton.
Right.
Funding going to Orlando and Dayton. And I did it half-heartedly over the Christmas holiday, starting approximately now. Mm-hmm. And over the Christmas holiday, well, I was busy doing the videos for Tapper, put no effort into it whatsoever, and it ended shortly after the first of the year. So it probably did much better than I thought. I think I set it for $8,000, and I think it collected about $800. Which, of course, it didn't. Well, the Kickstarter, you don't get anything. You don't get anything. So I'll call that a dismal failure.
Yeah.
I won't do that again.
Yep.
But I didn't go to Orlando, because I couldn't afford to. I did go to Dayton, and you didn't come with me.
No, I was there.
But you had a good
and
time.
And I saw
you. Yeah. So way out there on the West Coast, have you ever guys heard of Dayton?
Yes, we have heard of Dayton. I haven't gone to Dayton, but lots of people in my ham radio club have.
Fly, I imagine.
They fly generally, yes.
Yeah, it's a lot. I drove out there 2 years ago. Long trip. All right, so I think we've covered just about everything you're going. Is there anything that you have percolating on the back of your mind that you've been saying, I want to talk about or I wish they'd ask?
No, I feel like you guys really covered most of it. I guess in summary, I'd say I encourage everyone to do a project like this. Definitely think about the legal aspects of owning a trailer and start building that social network now for when you need it in the future.
I have a question for Adam.
Oh, sure.
Yeah. Adam, you've been involved in a lot of the red tape and the more difficult part that nobody wants to be involved in. Will you be involved in the actual building of the trailer and the equipment installation and all that? And if you'll be working on that yourself, when do you think that'll be going on? Pretty soon?
We're hoping to have a good feel for budget mid-January. If this is going to tie up towards the end of January, we'll have a good budget number then. Part of the incentive to be part of the project is a collective sort of community or group-based design process for the trailer. So we're going to try and involve as many people as we can and make it a real fun exercise. I probably won't be leading the design, but I might be leading the process by which we achieve a design.
Okay.
You'll be saying things like, we don't have enough money to do that.
So
pretty, we don't have enough money to do that.
Pretty exactly. Soon, though. A couple of months, not a year.
I mean, even after they've collected all their money, someone's still got to hold expectations to a reasonable level. So you probably got electricians, engineers, woodworkers, mechanical.
They've all volunteered that are in members of Multnomah County areas right now. In fact, one member builds trailers. Again, this is Portland, right? So there's a movement towards tiny houses. You know, maybe 300 square foot houses is a big thing out here right now. And there's a lot of them are mobile, like built on trailers. And so there's a gentleman in the club who builds those. And he said, well, I could build one of those pretty easy. So we've got a variety of interesting people with interesting skills that I think if we get to the build process, it's going to be a lot of fun.
I think they will.
Good.
Sound pretty enthusiastic about it.
Yeah.
All right. Well, good luck.
Let's talk to him in 6 months and see how it's going.
Yeah, let us know.
Yeah.
You need Jeff.
Yeah, Jeff, come on out.
Jeff has mad skills.
He mentioned a fix-it fair early on. It might have been before we were rolling.
What is a fix-it fair?
A fix-it fair is a community. It's put on by the city, and it's a community event that highlights resources that are available to the community. So, like personal preparedness, things are there. The PGE, the local power companies, show up and say, "Hey, did you know all about all these programs for low income and heating, energy improvement abatements?" So there'll be like 30 or 40 essentially tables or desks at a school where people can come and find out information. So we've often had both Aries and general ham radio tables there just to sort of wave the flag.
All right, that sounds cool. I was thinking a fix-it fair would be something you do after I try to build something or to work on something. And
the aftermath of the maker fair.
Yes,
exactly. There you go. At Adam's house, every day is a fix-it fair, really.
Yeah, all right. So you guys have your Indiegogo campaign going. I have Arvin sitting back there, chief financial officer for Ham Radio Now. So now you out there in the viewing audience have a choice to make. Where are you going to send your money? A one-time offer. Jeff, let's do it. Let's do it this way. Whoops, wrong button. There, me and Jeff. A one-time offer. Split your money. I'm not going to say send it all to them. Split your money. If this episode got you to say maybe cough up $10, send them $5. Send me $5. My $5 goes to hamradionow.tv. Easy to find on the web. Hamradionow.tv. Don't send any money to Jeff.
No.
Jeff doesn't need it.
I'm not good with money anyway. I wouldn't make good use of it.
Okay. Adam, have you ever made it to the end of a Ham Radio Now show? Not very many people have.
You know, I think maybe, but I may have skipped to the end.
Yeah, a lot of people see the beginning of the shows. Not very many people make it to the end. Do you know how we finish these programs?
How do you finish these programs?
Well, we say something that is, and I keep getting email and comments about these. This is bad radio procedure. If I'm doing this by myself, I just stare into the camera and I say, "Thanks for watching. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. In this case, it will be, "I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ.
And Jeff Wittick, AC4ZO.
Your turn.
And I'm Adam Carroll, KF7LJH.
And then I would say over and out, which is bad radio procedure, as people have explained to me. Because over means you transmit. Out means I'm gone. So it was way back when I was doing Ham Nation. It was the first time I started saying that. And instantly got somebody sending an email saying, "That makes no sense." And so the next Ham Nation, I explain how it makes sense. It makes sense in the following way. You can transmit. I'm not going to be listening.
People have told me CQ on 2 meters doesn't make sense.
Well, that
to me, it makes lots of sense.
Somebody was calling. Somebody called CQ on. It wasn't 5.2. It was on a repeater.
Yeah.
Around here, just the other day.
Yeah. And yeah, we both heard it.
I probably wouldn't have answered him except that he called CQ. And I got to answer this guy, so I did, and we had a pleasant talk for a while. You were listening.
Yeah.
You didn't break in.
Nope.
Just sat there,
yep.
Sat there listening. Yep. All right, so we're going to use this horrible radio procedure. I will begin. Jeff, you get the middle. Adam, you wrap it all up, and we will fade to black. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ.
Jeff Wittick, AC4ZO.
And Adam Carroll, KF7LJH.
Over.
And?
Out.
You got it. Eventually.
That was good.
It's the Skype delay.
Yeah.
I like that. And it's better than breaking into song at the end, really.
Oh, we never thought of that.
next show. Next show. Episode 170. What was this? 177? 178. Yeah. Stay tuned for 178.
Gary and Jeff in a ram.
No, but I've got something. Okay. Bye-bye, you guys.